Hey, it's Liz DiAlto, and this is the Untame the Wild Soul Woman podcast. From body image, sex, spirituality, money, and relationships, to motherhood, creativity, business, communication, and desire, Untame the Wild Soul Woman is the place to come for real stories and powerful advice to help you reclaim and redefine womanhood in the 21st century. What's up, y'all? Welcome to episode number 156 of the Untame the Wild Soul podcast. I'm your host, Elizabeth DiAlto. And today, for those of you who are watching, you can see this, I am coming to you from my bed in the room at the retreat, the Wild Soul Movement Teacher Training Retreat. We had, for the first time on the show, an episode that was scheduled, didn't work out according to the schedule. So I'm doing an impromptu solo episode. I haven't done one of these since last summer, but it's on a topic that I've been excited and meaning to talk about anyway, because I get so many questions about this. It comes up in my groups all the time. And for those of you who have been following along or paying attention for the last 6 months to a year or so, you know that I personally just went through a breakup of a pretty serious relationship. And I've written about this before. I've written articles. I've done little mini classes on other people's platforms. And so how to get the most out of a breakup is a topic I'm super passionate about, because I remember in my early 20s, my first couple of like major breakups of long-term relationships, I would just not get the most out of them. I would, you know, grieve and be dramatic and say mean things and do weird things. And so I've since learned, really, the last couple of relationships I've come out of, I've taken the experience of the breakup and really found a way to use them as growth opportunities, as wake-up opportunities, and as launching pads, right? Like, breakups do not have to necessarily just be tragic or sad endings. They can be really the stepping stone into very beautiful and bright beginnings. So we're going to be talking about that today. I have like 6 or 7 points. I wrote down a bunch of notes because I actually have so much. I could literally do an entire masterclass about this. I have friends wanting me to write a book called How to Break Up Like a Boss. I'm not writing a breakup book, but I have a lot to cover and I want to make sure I keep track. So I do have some notes that I'll be following along with. And those of you who are listening won't notice that, but those of you who are watching along will see me looking down. And so, you know, that's what I'm looking down at, so I can avoid going on too many tangents and stick to the points that I want to share with you. Couple announcements before we get into the episode. It is in real time. If you're watching this, it's Monday, February 27th. And so that means that there's 1 day left to enroll for a Wild Soul Movement weekend workshop at the early bird rate of $400 instead of $500. So we have 4 of those coming up this year already on the calendar. We might do some more this year. We'll see. But Southern California, I was originally planning to do that one in the Los Angeles area, and that's been moved to San Diego. So that'll be in San Diego, April 22nd to the 23rd. In May, we'll be in Vancouver from May 27th to 28th. In June, I'll be in Salt Lake City, Utah from June 17th to 18th. And then I'll be in Toronto the 15th and the 16th of July. So if you're interested in a 2-day weekend workshop with me and some other amazing Wild Soul women from all over the place, go ahead and head on over to wildsoulmovement.com/2017 workshops. All the details, all the locations, everything is there. And I am so pumped. Like, I literally can't wait to meet so many of you in real life who I've been interacting with online for so many years, and obviously to be reunited with those of you who I have already met before. So check that stuff out. And now let's get into this episode. So let me tell you what I'm going to be covering here. I wrote down 6 major points. 1 is the grieving process. 2 is how to use the energy that comes back to you once you are no longer in a relationship. 3 is how to extract the lessons. 4 is taking your time and giving yourself plenty of time. 5 is the art of not beating yourself up and how to be super gentle with yourself throughout the process. 6 is boundaries. And those of you who listen to the podcast know I'm huge on boundaries in all ways, in all aspects, in context, in all different areas of life. And this is huge when you're going through a breakup. And here's the deal. Whether you are going through a breakup right now, can see one in your near future, maybe you're recently out of one, maybe you're a long time out of one, you might still get stuff from this episode, because I've noticed from past relationships, when I go through future breakups, things come up that I hadn't resolved the last time. So a lot of this stuff is residual effect.
We'll talk about having safe people and having qualified people to help you through if there was any kind of codependency or emotional abuse, or maybe if you were with a narcissist, or all kinds of things that can make relationships and leaving relationships and stuff like that really messy. But also, again, in every mess, there is a possibility for a miracle. There is a possibility for just tremendous, tremendous healing. So let's dive in here. I want to start with grieving. So when you come out of a relationship, you know, sometimes you're the one who someone ended a relationship that you wouldn't have chosen to end. Sometimes you're the one choosing to end a relationship and the other person is not wanting to end the relationship. And sometimes it's mutual. I mean, those are kind of the three ways that a relationship comes to an end. One person wants it or both people want it. And even if you were the person who wanted it and it was your choice and you're into it and know it's for the best, even if it wasn't your choice and you know it was for the best, there's still grief, right? It doesn't mean that you're like elated and moving on right away, because when you've been so intimately involved and connected with a person for any length of time, there is some disentangling to do, right? And depending if you were living together, if you were married, if there are children involved, if you were really close with the family, if you have mutual friends, there's all these factors that will impact how easy or difficult it is to disentangle your life from this person's life. And in some cases, you actually can't, because again, if you have a kid together or, you know, whatever is the other reason. And so the grief process, you know, when it's fresh, when it's just happening, you have to give yourself some room and some leeway to just be irrational, to be emotional, to just, you know, be so tender with that grief. And this doesn't just go for breakup grief. This is all grief. Just knowing in those first few days, in those first few weeks, maybe even in the first few months, that it might be pretty easy to knock you off your center, right? If a song reminds you of that person, if you go to a place you used to go to with this person, and it might not be till later that some of these things hit you as well. So, but in those first few really tender days, weeks, and months, you've got to just allow whatever, you know, keep some tissues around. Maybe you're a person who cries, maybe you're not. Maybe you're a person who journals, maybe you're not. Maybe you talk it out with friends, maybe you have a therapist, but whatever it is, there needs to be some kind of outlet for the grief. You can't just hold it in your system. Don't just hold it together and pretend it's not happening. Like, it's real and it happened, and it doesn't make you weak that you're upset. So the recent relationship that I came out of, it was very mutual. We both knew the relationship had run its course. We were super complete. And even though I wanted to move on, I was actually very, very excited and looking forward to moving on. Of course, there were all kinds of things. Like, there were hurts. Often in relationships, the grief also happens because there are things you can't see and feel, things that you were not admitting to yourself until you've actually been able to extricate yourself from the situation, until you've gotten some distance from that person. In some cases, if there has been any kind of, again, codependency, emotional abuse, really unhealthy patterns or behaviors going on between the two of you, you might not even know it was happening until you get that hindsight, right? Or until someone says to you, hey, you know, I can relate to that. I had this happen. I had an experience like that recently where a woman had shared something with me about her divorce, and it helped me to realize something that had totally been happening in my relationship that I didn't know. And even having that realization and that acknowledgement and being able to look back on the entire relationship with like just one new little piece of information gave me a lot of understanding, but it also gave me a lot of stuff to grieve and to heal and to work through. And so just understand that grief is a really interesting thing. It may be quick, it may not. It may, you know, you comes in waves, I find. You know, over the course, many months later, something can happen and you'll be like, oh, I'm still upset about this thing, and it's totally okay. I find sometimes in my own history and working with other people, we place these expectations on ourselves that I should be over this right by now, right? Or maybe someone says that to you. Maybe an insensitive person is like, just get over it, or you're still talking about this, which is why I'll get to it later on in the episode. it's just so freaking important to have like the safe people that you could be unfiltered, unadulterated, unevolved with, who are just going to hold you and support and listen to you. So be mindful of your grieving process and be really gentle with yourself. Don't be competitive about it. You know, I think this can happen where what's interesting, I remember a couple breakups ago, someone shared with me, you know, coming out of a relationship sometimes is almost harder than dealing with a death. Because when someone dies, you do not have to watch their life go on without you in it. And because we live in the age of social media, we can do those things, right? So some people I know do like the clean split. They unfriend people on Facebook. They unfollow them on Instagram. Like they do all these things and they don't follow. Some people don't have that level of self-control. Like some people continue to check up and look and see what their former partner is doing. And, you know, I can see there's usefulness in that. But there's also, if it's self-violent, if it's self-abusive, because it's upsetting to you and it's interrupting your healing process, certainly don't do things like that. You might have great intentions of being friends with this person, and maybe you can easily transition into that, or maybe it's just going to take some time, or maybe you get out of the relationship and you realize, you know what, I can't have any interaction with this person. And so just be prepared for things looking different than you had probably thought or projected into the future that they might look, and understand that that might impact the grieving process. The second point on using the energy is my absolute very favorite thing about breakups. And I remember my friend Mary Catherine. So after my most recent relationship ended, I had lived with my partner. And so I found this beautiful place and I was in a position to be able to decorate it and get anything I wanted. And really for the first time ever, set up a home sanctuary exactly the way that I wanted it. And you know, I had a feng shui person come, and my goal with my place was that, you know how sometimes you're somewhere and when you walk outside, you can take a deep breath and be like, oh, I feel so good out here. I wanted to be able to feel that when I stepped inside my own home. And it was so awesome. The first couple friends who came over, who'd walk in and they'd be like, oh, this is amazing. And like, literally, that's exactly how I wanted to feel. So it felt so nice that other people felt that way too. But my friend Mary Catherine walks into my house and she was with me. I've known her for years. So she was with me during my last breakup as well. And she looks around my house and she's like, man, nobody does a breakup like you do. And the reason for that is, regardless of the grief, regardless of the pain, regardless of like anything that's going on, something I've been super aware of the last many years is that the energetics of a relationship. When you have been in a relationship, and also when it's on like its last legs or it's on its way out, you are, a lot of your energy is going towards that one area of your life or that one person in your life. So when that category, when that relationship, when that person is removed from your life, all of a sudden, all the energy that was going towards that thing is now available again for you. And you get to take that energy and put it towards whatever you want to put it towards, whether it's the healing from the relationship, whether it's a project, a creative project, maybe you want to travel, maybe it's other relationships, right? When you're in a romantic relationship, often you don't spend as much time in your friendships as you want to. So maybe it's that, maybe it's time with your kids, maybe it's reconnecting with your family. You know, something that I really did was I kind of zoomed out and I looked in on the rest of my relationships. Where were my friendships? Who was I connected to? And I decided to really double down on going deeper and cultivating more nourishing relationships with the people who were really important to me. And it was just so fun. So you use that energy. You now have all this back. It's for you. You can use it for your self-care. You could read books you've been wanting to read. You could take a course. You could start an activity that you didn't have time to do before because, you know, you were working on this relationship or, you know, whatever it was. So just understand that you have so much more energy available to you now for you. And so get excited about that. Even, and these different emotions, they can exist at the same time. You can be grieving and be really excited about something at the same time. One does not deny the other. And so really consider that. Really consider, oh man, I'm thinking back on the first time I realized that emotions could coexist and being like, I feel sad, but I feel elated at the same time. Don't let it confuse you. You don't need to overanalyze it. You might not be bypassing anything. It might just legitimately be that you feel more than one thing at the same time, and that's all right. So use that energy. The next point is to extract the lessons. And here's the deal. This kind of goes back to the grief point. It might be too early sometimes. Like day two of a breakup might not be the day to start looking at, you know, what went wrong? How did I show up? How could I have shown up better? What can I learn from this so that I don't have to repeat the habits, the patterns, and the way this played out? You know, give yourself some time and space before you start digging into that. Like, give yourself some time to get the raw emotions, the raw feelings out of your system so that it can actually be useful and so that you can actually see those things clearly. Because when you're clouded and mired in really intense emotions, you're not seeing stuff clearly anyway. You really do often need that, like, bird's eye view, you know, a month, 2 months, 3 months, many, many months out. So I'm like, I don't know, 4 or 5 months out, 6 months, I don't know, out of my relationship. And there's new stuff. I'm being like, oh, like I'm being able to see things. Cause again, I'm like so far zoomed out now. And so that's really useful. So extract the lessons. And how do you do that? So I highly recommend, whether it's working with a therapist, whether it's finding an expert, reading relationship books, just a couple of the things that have really helped me in the past and even presently coming out of relationships. Number one, those of you who listen to the podcast know my good friend Terry Cole. And if you have not listened to that episode, it's at untameyourself.com/episode-147. And in that episode, we talk about codependency, we talk about gaslighting, we talk about some really, really useful downloaded love blueprints. So many of us, when our relationships go south, it's because we are repeating the patterns that we learned, that we picked up, that we observed in childhood, and we don't even necessarily know that we have them. So identifying and uncovering, like, what are your beliefs about relationship? How do you show up? How do you behave when things are stressful? Like, what are your triggers? What are the things that set you off? Those things are really useful. There's a book called Getting the Love You Want by, I believe it's Harville Hendricks. It might be Harville Hendrickson. Check out that one. There's a book called Attached. There's a concept in psychology called attachment theory, which is really useful in understanding how, again, how you interact with people depending on how the relationship is going. There is the work of Byron Katie, which when my last breakup in 2013, this was enormously helpful for me. I listened to her audiobook, I Need Your Love, Is It True? And that really, really helped me. Something this time around that helped me much more than anything has ever helped me before actually was doing energy work, doing forgiveness work and doing cord cutting and grounding myself. And so if you haven't listened to my episode with Siobhan Moran, I believe it's episode number 91, but we'll put it in the show notes. The show notes for this episode will be at untameyourself.com/episode-156. But I'm pretty sure it was episode 91 with Siobhan. And we talked about cord cutting. We talked about the need to be right. There's some really useful energetic stuff in that episode that can help in the breakup process and the grieving process and all that stuff. Forgiveness work is huge. I have a video on how to do forgiveness practice at untameyourself.com/forgiveness. And while, you know, depending on how and why your relationship ended and whether or not your ex-partner, you know, behaved well or not well, you might want to forgive that person. But more than anything, you're going to want to forgive yourself. And this kind of goes into the next point about not beating yourself up. The fact of the matter is, so many of us don't know what we don't know when it comes to relationships. And we can be really amazing in friendships. We could be really amazing in other stuff. We could be awesome at our job. You could be an amazing mom. Like, you might be super fit. Like, you might be so smart in other areas of your life. And then when it comes to relationship, you're like, how is it possible that I could have such a gaping blind spot, or that I could have such a gap in, you know, how these things go or how I show up or in my development, right? Or in my maturity, or, you know, my understanding of human behavior, whatever it is. And so instead of beating yourself up about that, doing the forgiveness work around yourself and releasing yourself from any unreasonable expectation that you should know any better when you've never had any training. If you've never like studied it, if you've never had the experience, and here's the other thing, this was part of my experience. It was very humbling. I've studied this stuff. I've read tons of these books. I've been through some of these things before. I help other people effectively with their relationship stuff. And there were huge blind spots for me that I realized coming out of this last relationship. And part of why you cannot beat yourself up for that is because this is what relationships are for. Relationships are growth catalysts. Relationships romantic and intimate relationships especially, are able to hold up a mirror in our life to ourselves in ways that no other kind of relationship is. And so you learn things, and it's, you could be tempted to really beat yourself up, really be down on yourself. But the fact of the matter is, if you'd never learned before, if you never had awareness before, or like, I didn't even know what codependency was. And then I was like, oh damn, I've been doing that forever, because I learned it in my house growing up. You know, that's just how we've always rolled. And so you start to realize where these things came from. And when you can get to the root of things, you can really release yourself. You can forgive yourself. You can forgive other people. And just understand that you're always going to attract a partner who's going to very specifically be able to show you the areas that you need to work on. It might not always be, it doesn't always have to be this like intense growth thing. There can be ease, there can be stability, there can be lots of pleasure and joy and fun. But likely, when a relationship ends, there's some really cool things to learn, and it's a total waste of time to beat yourself up about anything that you didn't know. And so the next point is, again, take your time. And I've said this already, but you know, even now, so I'm recording this episode, I'm in Spain, I'm traveling. And for the last 6 months or 5 months or so, I've been nesting. I've been in my little sanctuary that I built for myself in San Diego. I've just been relaxing, really deepening my personal practices of prayer and movement and meditation and taking really amazing care of myself and contemplation and journaling and studying and creating things. I've been in a huge creation phase, creating the Wild Soul Movement Weekend workshops, creating my teacher training, launching my mentorship program this year, which was entirely new, and I updated the curriculum. We're making an oracle deck, the Wild Soul Oracle, which is coming out in June. We're launching a storytelling platform. Like, so much creation is happening in my world and in my life right now. As I mentioned earlier, I've been doubling down on friendships, like really going deep with some people and spending amazing time and having like epic beach walks and dinners and having people over and just really, really, really enjoying connection with people and like real love and like a non-romantic sense, which has been so nourishing for me. And I come on this trip and I start traveling, which was something I knew I wanted to do. I didn't really know why. And I realized, like, damn, it's intense. And it just so happens that the last time I went on a big trip, I went on a big trip with my ex. And he's a great traveler. And he did all the driving and he did a lot of navigating and figuring of things out. And so for me, even coming here and being like, oh man, having like little moments of appreciation for all the things that he did, that at that time, that was towards the end of our relationship, I probably wasn't really appreciating so much because I was more like super frustrated and irritated and just like ready to go and ready to be done with the relationship, even though it was a friendly and mutual thing. And so it's been cool to just notice, because I hadn't had this experience of doing something on my own yet that I had been doing together with a person for the last 3 years. It brought up some more stuff for me to look at. And so just remembering to take your time and to be gentle with yourself every time something new comes up for you to face or something new comes up for you to look at. It doesn't make you weak. It doesn't make you bad. There's no competition of like who moves on faster. You know, it's about your own experience, your own journey, your own pace, and really getting those lessons, like we just said, however long it takes, so that you can look at things and go, cool, where's my contrast? What happened in that relationship that I never want to experience again? What do I need to learn? Who do I need to be? What do I need to heal or transform or transmute so that that shit doesn't happen again? So the next time I attract a partner, it could be someone who's much more aligned with who I am now. And that's another part of it, right? Like sometimes the reason relationships end, like my last two relationships were like this. We were both so growth oriented and we just grew in different directions. And so it was no longer an aligned match. And so it doesn't make me wrong. It doesn't make them wrong. It just literally wasn't a fit anymore. So being gentle with yourself around that, not beating yourself up and taking your time. And you'll notice, as I go through this, I hear myself repeating a couple things over and over and over again. And I just want you to trust that I'm not being repetitive. I'm not being redundant. It's actually that important to pay attention to those things and really take them in. Boundaries. Oh, y'all, this is a big one. And this is really, really important because other people, some of whom are super, super well-meaning, can really interrupt your healing process. And so there's two aspects of boundaries that I want to cover here. The first one is be mindful of what you share and who you share it with. So not everyone in your life is going to be privy to all of the dirty details of the relationship and what happened and why it ended. And this is important for your own self-preservation and your own energy, because some people are just going to project their own experiences onto yours. Some people are going to want to give you unsolicited feedback that you don't want. Some people are going to say things that they think are helpful that aren't. And I'll give you an example. A prime example is the people who want to be like, I never liked him anyway, or I always thought you were better than him, or blah, 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 blah. They think they're being supportive, but like the fact is, like, you did love that person. You did spend a good amount of time with that person. And so those types of statements are not always helpful. So you want to be sure that you're sharing only what needs to be shared, right? Like you don't have to give everyone who asks all the details. It's also great for you to not continuously relive it and not continuously put like drama and bring up the feelings of anger, resentment, whatever. That happened to me a few times. Like people would ask, and even if it was someone safe, I'd like share a little bit, but then I'd notice afterwards, I just felt like shit because I just didn't need to be talking about it anymore. I was actually dragging it out and prolonging it every time I talked about what I had already resolved. So that's one place to have a boundary in terms of what you share. As you move along and as you heal and as you have resolved certain aspects, there's just be mindful of relaying facts and details and crossing the line into rehashing and rewounding and just throwing crappy energy on it. The other thing is, you know, some people might have some valuable experience. Like I know for me, the people who I would share the details with and like really open up about like what was going on, how I was feeling, why the relationship ended and all that stuff were people who I had known had valuable experience and people who were in amazing relationships now. Like there were a couple women in my life who either had previous relationships or previous marriages before they met the actual person, like their partner. And so I was super interested to spend time with those people and hear like their experiences. There were a couple things I mentioned earlier that I realized after the relationship that I was dealing with, codependency being one of them. So speaking with people who had been through that, who had been codependent and knew what that was like unwinding that, I wanted to talk to people who'd experienced what I was going through, not anyone and everyone who'd ever been through a breakup, because some people just don't have good advice to give, or some people aren't good at listening, or some people just want you to feel better. And so they're not going to hear you. They're just going to like say trite, encouraging things that aren't always encouraging. They might come from good places, or some people just don't want to be around upset people. And, you know, I love my parents and I love my family. And sometimes like all they want is for their baby to not be upset or to not be hurt. Right. So I remember my parents came to visit and they were staying at a hotel near my place and we were sitting by the pool and I was talking about something and I started crying and my mom was like, don't cry here. And I'm like, I'm going to cry wherever the fuck I want, you know, like, and so, but again, there's nothing wrong with my mom saying that. She just like didn't want me to be upset. And like, those were the words that came out of her mouth, but it actually made me more upset because I was like, I'm going to cry. I'm going to be upset. Don't tell me what to do, you know? So again, just giving you a couple of examples so you could take a look and take stock and take inventory in your own life around, you know, who are the safe people to talk to about what things and why, and being, having boundaries around that. You're also more than welcome to tell people, you know what, like, I don't feel like talking about that today, but thank you so much for asking. I'm working on it, right? It's totally okay. Not everyone is entitled to your story. Not everyone is entitled to your full story. Not everyone is entitled to even any tiny detail that you don't feel comfortable, that you don't want to give. And this is important too. Don't trash talk your ex, you know, like there's just no reason to throw this person under the bus. Like this is why you do want to have those safe people, like have those people that you could just be your unevolved self. You can just say whatever you want to say and just get it out of your system. All the irrational things, the things you don't even mean. But again, be mindful about who you say those things with and be mindful that those people just know that you're just like venting or letting off steam. And I certainly wouldn't do it in any kind of like social media or like public setting. And you have to be careful too. If you're someone listening and you have any kind of public persona or a blog or a brand, there were a couple times I noticed where I would post something and it was about my experience. It was not directly related to my ex. It was not meant to be a dig at him or anything like that. But people have been following along and people kind of knew the situation and people decided, I wrote this one post in particular that people decided to be like, he's an asshole, or this and this, and like just make comments. And I'm like, this wasn't about him. And the reason why that was so upsetting to me is because it wasn't about him. That wasn't my intention. And my experience of like the thing that I wanted to share that was cathartic for me to share was robbed by people making it about him when it wasn't about him. And so you just want to be mindful if you're sharing anything on like social media or in any kind of public setting, how you word things and just knowing that people are going to misinterpret you. People are going to misunderstand you and they're just going to project their own experiences. They're going to feel triggered by if they can relate to what you shared. So just be prepared for that and use the barometer of not sharing anything that's still really tender for you. And so that on that particular day, that share, it's not that it was tender for me, but it was just irritating. And I was like, all right, cool. Like good to know, note to self, that a lot of people who follow me also had followed him and know who he is. And I have to just be a little more diligent about if I mention him or if I reference him, even subtly or indirectly, because I'm not interested in people, you know, dragging him into what's my story and what's my process and what's my experience. And so that could happen in an online setting or in an offline setting. And so you just want to be mindful of that type of stuff as well. Getting qualified help, you know, if there was some serious like psychological or mental health or emotionally very intense things, you might want to get a therapist. You might want to do some EMDR. You might want to do some somatic experiencing. You might want to find an energy worker, an energy healer who can help you with all of these things. I have a video. I learned amazing cord cutting and grounding tools from Siobhan last year when I was working with her. So I have a video for that at untameyourself.com/energy if you want to learn how to cut your cords and ground yourself. It's really helpful. It's really helpful if you feel yourself gripped by some big emotion to just cut your cords and ground yourself before you say anything you don't mean or do anything you don't want to do and you make choices and decisions and things like that. So those were the points that I wanted to cover. I just want to look in my notes here. So, there's something I want to remind you. Just because a relationship doesn't work out in the sense that like you end up living happily ever after, it doesn't mean the relationship wasn't a success. There was a quote that I shared when my former partner and I broke up that is from Neil Strauss from his book, The Truth. And I'm going to paraphrase it now because I don't remember it verbatim, but it's something along the lines of relationships that it's not a failure if the relationship ends. It's a failure if the relationship goes on for too long. And this is one of the number one things I think that we all face when we're in a relationship and it's coming towards an end. It's like, do I stay? Do I go? Do I stay? Do I go? And so when you know, like I really just think you know when you know. You know when you know. I was 1 foot in, 1 foot out of my relationship for like a year and a half. And I just remember Siobhan saying to me, like, you'll know when it's time. And I totally did. And it's easy to maybe beat yourself up or think that you stayed for too long or anything like that. But the fact is there's really no way until it's done to go, oh, that was too long. Or, oh, I could have stayed longer. I could have continued to work on it. And it's always easy to make up and talk yourself into or out of anything in hindsight. So it's easiest if you're just willing to accept what is or what was and that this is what happened. And let me just work with that. Let me work with the information. And so I'm just scanning here for 1 second, seeing if there's anything else. Oh, yeah, perfect. So this is what I want to wrap up on. It could be really sad when a relationship ends because we're not just, in some cases, losing a person that was really special to us. Sometimes we're losing friends. Sometimes we're losing a connection to someone else's family, whatever it is. But there were hopes and dreams that went unrealized. There were plans that you had for the future. There were things that you were going to do together. There were things that you were going to do in your own life that you just imagined that this person would be by your side through it. And so you don't just lose the relationship, you don't just lose the person, you lose the hopes and the dreams and the future projections that you had made and maybe expectations that you had had. And so something that really is so beautiful about that is you do not have to lose the hopes and the dreams. you can keep those. You can hold on to those. You can continue to nurture and nourish those. And just know that you're going to swap out the character. You're going to find someone to play the role that you had imagined your former partner playing. And this person, this next person, will be a better fit. And that's another huge belief I have. Each relationship is always better in some way, shape, or form. Better is a very subjective qualifier, right? But each relationship is always better than the last. And so that's like when you come out of a relationship and if you were thinking, that was the love of my life, I'll never do any better than that, it's just not possible. It's just not possible. There's always more love where that came from. There's always better experiences where that came from. There's always more appropriate, more aligned experiences. Like you've grown, you've changed, you're a different person through that relationship and because of that relationship. And now the next time you go to attract partners, if you do your work, if you listen to yourself, if you allow yourself to grieve, if you have some really good boundaries, if you extract the lessons, the next relationship has to be better. So it's not about rushing to find that. And you might, who knows, you might meet someone very quickly and it's awesome. Or you might decide to take some time for yourself. Like that's something I'm doing this year. I even have a couple of my friends, I told them, I'm like, you know, you guys keep an eye on me because I could get really used to this single gig. It's just, it's lovely. It's lovely to just pour my own love into myself and do whatever I want and not have to consider another person and like go all in my business and just have so much fun there and get so much nourishment there and build relationships there. So I wanted to leave you guys with that thought that the hopes and the dreams do not have to die along with the relationship. You could just swap out the main character. So thank you so much for listening in the Facebook group. Come tell me, how is this helpful for you? Share it with the people you know who could use this right now. The Facebook group, as always, is at untameyourself.com/Facebook. I'd love to know your insights, deeper questions. I'm happy to do a follow-up episode on this. As I said, I'm super passionate about this. Breakups have been some of the most important evolutionary catalyst for me in my life. So I hope that was useful for you. If you're someone in a breakup or with a tender heart right now coming out of a relationship, I just want to send you a ton of love for that because I know it's tough. And I also want to let you know it will not feel like this forever. Like you get to come out on the other side of this and you totally will come out on the other side of this. So I'm super rooting for you. Appreciate you guys so much. Thank you for listening and we'll see you later.
One thing that I do feel about this is that if we can enact change in the change makers and in the top elite kind of financial and governmental and political kind of people, there's so much change that can happen from enacting change in that group of people. And yet, of course, it's important to feed the homeless. And of course, it's important to do other, you know, things that tithing and things that I've just created a nonprofit called Rama Foundation. We're just launching it this week, actually, our first launch party. And so I it's very dear to my heart to bring wellness and meditation and peace to places that is not, they don't have the kind of luxury that we have. Right. And I also feel working with the change makers and working with the people who have the money and have certain levels of power is very, very important.